Hey Fingsters, in this video I want to show you a very important topic with the title Python Profilers, how to speed up your Python app. And actually, I mean the title suggests that it's just an introduction into the different Python profilers. But what I actually wanted to do is to help you speed up your application and save you weeks of time by avoiding to do the wrong things. Because, I mean, I know from my own experience I've really wasted months optimizing some code bases which I developed for my scientific research projects, and it can take forever. So if you don't know what you're doing, then you will waste a lot of time doing the wrong things in performance tuning. So therefore, this is not like, it's not an article that just introduces the top 10 Python profilers and gives you an overview about the different about the best profiling techniques or tools or so on. But it will be more a conceptual video which will show you conceptually how to approach performance tuning, because this is maybe 90% of the game is the conceptual part. And if you really master these concepts, if you maybe you can even write them up and print them, and if you know about these concepts, then performance optimization will be a breeze compared to what it will be if you just check out the next Python profiler and play with the tool and waste a lot of time. So this is about the concept of performing tuning. But so, and the good thing is that after understanding these conceptual framework, this conceptual framework, you can actually apply it to any programming language you want and for any application you will ever encounter in practice. And the bad thing is that you must change your expectations a bit. So I won't provide you with a magic tool that speeds up your program on the push of a button. Okay, so let's start with the list of 7 performance tuning rules. So these are the golden rules of performance tuning. I should name the title like this: the golden rules of performance tuning. So what are they? Okay, first of all, the first rule, I'll copy and paste this rule here, nothing to paste. The first rule is premature optimization is the root of all evil. Okay, what does it mean? So what is premature optimization? So the definition is premature optimization is the act of spending valuable resources, time, effort and lines of code, and even simplicity can be seen as a valuable resource, to optimize code that doesn't need to get optimized. Okay, and this is a very common problem for many coders. So many coders start optimizing their code, they spend a lot of time fixing the wrong parts of the code, and so they are very inefficient. So this is one of the major reasons for coding inefficiency. And you don't need to take my word for it. So one of the most famous computer scientists of all times, Donald Knuth, who actually got the Turing Award and so on, said about premature optimization, programmers like maybe I can show you so you can also read. No, this is not what I wanted to do. Okay. So programmers waste enormous amount of time thinking about or worrying about the speed of non-critical parts of their programs. And these attempts at efficiency actually have a strong negative impact when debugging and maintenance are considered. We should forget about small efficiencies, say about 97% of the time. Premature optimization is the root of all evil. Okay, so from Donald Knuth. And you should really consider this statement. And the thing is, I mean, we will go into this detail later, but yeah, he says that 97% of the time you don't need to fix these small efficiencies, which means that 97% of your optimization time will be waste. It will just a waste of resources. And that's why some coders are 1,000 times more productive than other coders, because they take this to their heart. So they just write clean, simple, understandable code, so like the naive code bases, and then they just tune what needs to be tuned. So they don't tune in advance. They just write readable code and do it quickly. So a good heuristic is to write the most readable code per default. And if this leads to an interactive application, it's already fast enough, then yeah, fine. But if users of your application start complaining about speeds, then take a structured approach to performance optimizations, okay? So, and what is a structured approach? We will go into this in many detail later. Yeah, but now, for now, there are some action steps you should consider. Making your code as readable and concise as you can. You need to use comments and adhere to the standards, which is, for example, PEP 8 standard in Python, and do a lot of testing, ship your application early to the user, and only if you get user feedback that the application is too slow, then you need to start optimizing, okay? But not before. Do not do pre-major optimization. It's one of the most wasteful things you can do in coding. And then if you have, so if you are sure that you need to optimize your code, then before you start optimizing the code and implement and downloading the next hot tool or so, you shut down the current performance of your app. Okay, and only if you know where you are, you can actually start improving. And yeah, so, and then the second thing you should write down is whether you want to optimize for speed, for bytes, or for memory, or yeah, whatever. So what do you want to actually optimize? And then not only on a very high level, but on a very specific level, what is your goal? Like, should your app load in 2 seconds or in 3 seconds? Or so what is your concrete goal in performance optimization? So this, you should be very sure about these things before you move on to the next point. Okay, so what is the next point? The next point is measure first, improve second. Okay, so only what you measure gets improved. What you don't measure doesn't get improved. And yeah, so this is basically, it can be seen as a consequence of the first principle. Pre-major optimization is the root of all evil. Because, I mean, if you do pre-major optimization, so you optimize things that don't need to get optimized, you basically optimize before you measure, before you already know what's the problem with your code. Okay, and therefore, if you measure, then if you measure first and only then you optimize, then chances are that you are not doing pre-major optimization, okay, which is a good thing. So, yeah, you should start measuring your code. So if you are unsure, then just measure your code. Take the seconds, take the byte overhead of your code, and only then start improving. So that also you see whether your so-called improvements made some progress towards your goal or not. I mean, if you don't measure it, you are basically lost in just dumb optimization. Yeah, moving on. Because you can optimize code forever. There's basically always the next bottleneck lurking around, and you won't finish optimization if you are not very sure what you want to achieve. Good, so this in a quick example is Google Page Speed site. So if you type in Page Speed Insights, here you can optimize a certain URL, say my application finkster.com. It analyzes URL and then it gives you some performance hints. And yeah, it gives you a score and you can optimize for this score. For example, you can aim for 100% score. Yeah, so no matter, we won't wait now. It's not important, but you can, yeah, you see there's a score and we can optimize the score. It's actually not very fast. So there is something to optimize in the application, but actually it's also not, this score is not everything, because you see here the time to interactive is really, really low. I mean, already in the second frame here, you see the app. So if you open the app, it feels interactive, even if the score may be low and not optimal, it feels interactive because we can like instantly see the application. And this was my main goal. But of course, I mean, I could optimize some images and so on. But as I told you, I'm not doing pre-major optimization. So there has never been a complaint about the speed. The speed, it feels interactive. It's very fast. And actually, I never had any indication that the app is too slow. So I don't start optimizing and spending a lot of time optimizing the code just for the purpose of optimizing it. Good. Then going back. So what are the action steps now with this second crucial element, a crucial rule: measure first, improve second. Action step, you start with a naive solution that's easy to read, and the naive solution is mostly easy to read, and then you take the naive solution as a benchmark, you measure the performance, and then you optimize and tweak. you really need to, I mean, a good scientific process is to document your measurements, for example, in a Google spreadsheet or an Excel spreadsheet, and then you come up with alternative code, you test the alternative code, measure its performance against the benchmark. If you have improved on the benchmark, then you have a new benchmark, which is your alternative, your new code. If you have, if you are worse than your benchmark in some key metrics like speed or memory overhead or so on, then of course you take the old benchmark. So you will always just improve your code base and optimize. You are sure to make improvement. Okay, then a third critical rule, and this is maybe the most important rule, is the Pareto principle. So you may know it already, the 80-20 principle. And it's really, no matter where you are looking in performance optimization, you will see it everywhere. Everywhere. So 20% of the 20% of the causes lead to 80% of the effects, which means in performance optimizations, here I opened my task manager. Here you can look at the different applications I'm currently running. Okay, here you see the CPU usage by my applications, 12% by the, so the one application takes 3 times the CPU overhead of the second application. So if you rank those applications by CPU usage, then the first application dominates all the others. And actually the second also, there's usually a big difference between the second and the third and the fourth and so on. And it will rapidly decrease, and we have a long tail, so some, there are a lot of applications who take 0.5, 0.4% of the total CPU. Okay, so but you will always see this distribution, and if you so no matter where you are in performance optimization, this distribution always holds. And if you plot this, you will see like this typical Pareto curve. So if I, for example, this is another snapshot I did here. Cortana was taking most of my CPU time and search. And the funny thing is, so even if you like in this case, we find the bottleneck is Cortana, because Cortana takes most resources. It takes 8% of the total CPU resources on my computer. So even if I close Cortana, then the curve looks just the same. I mean, here you see now I've reduced Cortana. It looks just the same. Just the percentages have changed, but the like structurally, it's exactly the same curve. We still have a new bottleneck, and now we need to fix this bottleneck. So we always have one bottleneck, and this is our best leverage point in improvement, in performance improvement. So Pareto is king. So you always need to identify the bottleneck, which is the application that takes most of your resources. It can be the application, it can be the function, or anything. It's really a fractal thing. So it, I mean, we have this. 80-20 applies to the whole universe, like to all computers in the world, maybe, but it also applies within a single computer, within a single program. Always we have this 80-20 principle. So the 80-20 principle is always almost certainly you will find it's valid for all hierarchical steps you can take. Okay, it's a universal concept, and it's very powerful concept. And so performance optimization is fractal. As soon as you're done removing the bottleneck, there's a new bottleneck, and you just need to repeatedly remove the bottleneck to get maximal bang for your buck. So this is really the algorithm, the main performance optimization algorithm. If you are sure that you need to optimize, you have identified your goal, then you just follow the algorithm of identifying the bottleneck, which is the function or the application with the highest negative impact on your performance. You fix the bottleneck, and then you repeat this. Okay, this procedure. And oftentimes you only, because of the high leverage effect of your optimization, you oftentimes need to perform this algorithm only 2 or 3 times, so only 2 or 3 steps. Often in a single day, by just fixing 2 or 3 bottlenecks, you have improved the performance of your application by 95%. If you improve the first bottleneck only, you have already improved the performance of your application often by, say, 50-60%. Okay, so this is like in the nature of the programs. Don't ask me why. I mean, there are many, there's a lot of scientific reasoning why the power law distribution occurs in nature. For example, preferential attachment and so on. But I mean, this effect is just a very robust observation. You can find it everywhere, and especially in performance optimization. So you always need to identify the bottleneck, fix the bottleneck, and repeat. And as I said, you don't need to repeat very often to reach your desired performance level. So, of course, if you are in scientific computing, it's maybe a bit different. But even then, often if you have if you found 5 bottlenecks and removed them, then you are already way faster than the competition. So this is the algorithm. It's a simple algorithm. It ensures that you will always spend your effort most efficiently. And therefore, you should always actually follow this algorithm. Good, then this is a smaller thing, it's more tactic, but it's also nonetheless important. So the question is how to actually improve the or reduce the bottlenecks. Okay, so at this point you have already figured out that you need to optimize the code, you have user feedback that your application is slow, or you see it in Google Analytics or Google PageSpeed also shows you that your web application is slow. You also know where you want to go in seconds or bytes and where you are currently. And you also know the bottleneck. And for this, like to learn about the bottleneck, you will need a performance profiler, which we will discuss later. But for now, we assume you have the bottleneck. Now you need to figure out how to overcome it. And the best leverage point for you is algorithms and data structures. So always opt for algorithmic optimization first. So if you don't know how to remove a bottleneck, then algorithms and data structures are often the way to go. So because you often can reduce computational complexity significantly, like from a quadratic function to the logarithmic function or so, or n log n function in this case. So there are many, like sorting, for example. You can, like a naive sorting algorithm would have squared computational complexity. If you are interested in this topic, then just Google it, computational complexity. But oftentimes, it's like the naive sorting algorithm is a squared complexity. In the number of list elements you want to sort, and much better algorithm have n log n behavior, which is much faster. So we have like the difference, the algorithmic difference. So if this is the performance and this is the number of elements n, then if you sort like the naive sorting algorithm as squared runtime optimization, so if you like double if you do like if you basically double, say you double the number of elements here, then you may easily end up quadrupling the performance. Okay, so it's like it's a non-linear approach. So linear approach would be like if you double it here, you double it here, but it's not linear, it's often non-linear. So, and often you can reduce it to an almost linear behavior, like n log n, it feels linear for at least not too big of inputs. Okay, so therefore, like you always, this perform algorithmic optimization give you the very coarse, like this difference can be achieved by algorithmic optimization and by data structure optimization. So it's much more powerful than, for example, doing like just selecting another programming language, for example. So if you just go for another programming language, and you also may like reduce your performance, reduce your latency by half, for example, if you take C++ instead of Python, you may easily reduce your performance, your runtime overhead by half, but this half will stay constant, so no matter what's the input. I mean, even if the input doubles, then the time is much better spent by improving the algorithmic complexity of your application than just selecting other tools, selecting other programming languages. Because, I mean, maybe I can visualize this a bit better. Okay, so say we have a certain problem like sorting. Now, this is the quadratic solution. So, I write n squared. So, the naive solution, your naive algorithm, say you have the sorting function, you have implemented it by yourself, then this is your function, which means that you have larger input, your performance will go through, actually your, I call it latency, your latency will go through the roof, which means that your users will have to wait. So, selecting a better algorithm means that you have a much better performance behavior. Yeah. So for example, for the same input, you get much better speed behavior than for the quadratic function. So this is like the performance improvement you can achieve by algorithmic optimizations. But if you now select another, like instead of the algorithmic optimization, instead of implementing this one, this algorithm, you say you select C++. C++ will just behave like this. So it will be exactly the same. So the curve will look exactly the same, but it will be a bit faster. So it will be a bit below, say you have achieved like half of the performance. But it's, you can still see that it still goes through the roof for larger input sizes. So the tools give you constant time improvement, and algorithms and data structures can give you super linear performance improvements. So therefore, that's the best leverage point. Good, then another tactic is caching. All hail to the cache. So let's have a very quick example. So what is a cache? Cache means just you take some computations which you have already performed and just store them in a cache. So say we have this simple function, the Fibonacci function. Okay, here, this function. It takes as input, takes the number n as input, it checks whether n is smaller than 2, then it returns the number. So for example 0 and 1, it will just return 0 or 1. If it is larger than 2, then or equal than 2, then it will just solve it recursively. So it will calculate the Fibonacci, the nth Fibonacci number as the sum of the n minus first Fibonacci number and the n minus second Fibonacci number. And it uses the function uses itself, so it's a recursive function call. And so this is a common way of implementing it, but it's very inefficient. Okay, so if you run this, let's say we run it for fib2 for input like 100, then we would have already, we need to wait. You see, I need to wait, and I actually don't know how long I need to wait. Probably I need to wait forever. So I will just finish it. Good, how can we improve? So in like the very simple approach, this is one approach I would always choose if I don't know how to improve performance of my function. Like say I want to improve the function f, fib function, then I would implement a caching system. Okay, so we need to define a cache. And we define a cache as a dictionary, and then we just check whether the number is already in our dictionary. If it is, then we return the stored value. So we store basically the nth Fibonacci number we store in our cache, in our dictionary. And because if we have already calculated it, why calculate it again? And you see, we will always recalculate the same Fibonacci number multiple times. Because, to calculate Fibonacci number, the nth Fibonacci number, we recursively call the function two times, which means that there will be a caller tree. So let's have some. So we have our Fibonacci function for n, and it will call Fibonacci for n minus 1 and for n minus 2. But now n minus 1 will also call for n minus 2 and n minus 3. And this one will also call for n minus 3 and n minus 4. So let's write it like n minus 3 and n minus 4. Okay, now very important, you see that here it calculates a number that has been already calculated here. Okay, so there's redundant computation of the same thing. And also, here it calculates a number that has been already calculated here. Okay, so there's a lot of redundancies in the code. We recalculate stuff again and again, which is very inefficient. So a cache helps overcome this problem, because if we have already stored it in our cache, we just return the value in our cache. And this is a very powerful concept. It can be applied to many, actually to all functions. If you have deterministic input, if you have one input value and the input value repeats, then we can just store the output of the function. And especially if the function is heavyweight, like the Fibonacci function, then this is a very efficient way of using your resources. And now say we run it for the input of 100. Let's check whether it's capable of doing it. Yeah, very quickly. It's already like finished. I have not printed it, but so we can print the result. But it's finished in a second or so, you see? So it's so fast, blazingly fast. But the different version, like this version, we would have to wait forever. I mean, it will just not terminate, actually. You see? I don't know how long it will take, but now it calculates. It starts with defining this function, then it executes the function, and it just runs and runs and runs and runs and runs because it's such an inefficient implementation. So there's so many redundant computations. Okay, but if you remove this, it's blazingly fast. We have immediately removed the bottleneck of the whole application. So therefore, like, the caching is always a very powerful trick to improve your performance in many cases. Good. Then, you can read the article if you are more interested in performance optimization with caching. Yeah, good. So then, then the next point is less is more. So if your problem is too hard, then just make it easier. Yeah, I know it sounds obvious, but many coders actually forget about this. Because if you're perfectionistic, you just want to implement every feature. But some features are very complicated to implement, and they have very limited value. And in this case, they will increase your code base significantly, and therefore introduce a lot of complexity, a lot of bugs and inefficiencies into your code base. And maintenance overhead, because each time you will search for a bug, you need to go over this very complicated code for this single feature. So I mean, there's always some opportunity cost. Yeah, so you need to understand this concept of opportunity cost. If you like implement one feature, you cannot implement another feature at the same time. So you have limited resources. Each time you decide for one feature, you decide against hundreds of other features. So therefore, it really pays off to think about whether you really need something. And minimalism is a very powerful concept for coding as well. So just implement like the minimum viable product, implement what you need to implement in order to like get the get 80-90% of the benefit for 10% of the work. Yeah, this is actually how you are successful in business, and coders often forget this. Coders often want to like finish everything, want to make everything perfectionistic. They never remove features. They simply always add features, always add complexity, and therefore reduce the performance of the application, reduce their utility of the application over time. Good. Then also very important, know when to stop. This is already contained in the second point. If you know what is your goal line, if you know your goal in a very specific number, so you know that, for example, your application 2 seconds is enough. If your application can terminate in 2 seconds, it's enough. Then of course you will stop if you have reached 2 seconds. You will not try to optimize more and more and more. Yeah, because usually if you optimize, it comes at a cost. So in some instances you can optimize at no cost. It makes the code prettier and the code also faster. But in many other cases, for example, when introducing a cache or so, it will make the code more complicated, but you will gain some performance. Again, you always need to trade these characteristics against each other. Okay, good. So this was the conceptual part, and now the like profiler part becomes easy, because now you simply the profiler. So what is the purpose of the profiler? It's just identifying the bottlenecks of your application. Okay, and the performance profiler allows you to monitor your application more closely. If you run just a Python script in your shell, you don't see anything but the output produced by your program, so you cannot really know what is the bottleneck. You don't see how many bytes consumed, how long each function runs, and so on. And therefore, you need a performance optimization, performance profiler. And fortunately, Python comes with a very powerful performance profiler, which is the C profiler. You can simply added to your application by import, by typing import C profile. That's it. Now you have access to the profiler. Okay, very simple statement. So say we have a function again. Let's do some coding. So remove everything here. We just copy and paste this part. Copy it and paste it. And now we can discuss the code. So say we want to calculate the prime numbers. So some a list of 100 random prime numbers. Okay, we import the random function. We develop a guess function, which just gives us a random number between 2 and 1000. It's very inefficient, but it's a naive approach. Like we only need to calculate 100 or X random prime numbers. This is our task. And then, so we guess a value, and then we check is the value a prime. If it is, so how do we check it? Actually, we have two nested for loops, for I in range X, for J in range X. So X is our prime number, which we want to check. We just calculate if I times J is X, then we already know that it's not a prime number, because it we can basically we have found two products when multiplied equal the prime number. Okay, and therefore the prime number has factorization, so it's not a prime number anymore. So we can return false. But if for any combination of numbers that are smaller than our prime number X, they cannot be multiplied to obtain the number X, then of course we have find the prime number, because there are no factor. There's no factorization. Okay, and our function find primes, basically for a certain number of primes we want to find, we simply repeat the following procedure. So for each prime number we want to search, we initially guess the prime number called P, and then we check. While not is prime P, we simply guess another one. So we check, we have our function is prime, which returns true. If we have found a prime number, it returns false if we have not found a prime number. And if we have not found a prime number, we simply guess it, a new number. And then again, we check whether this new number is not prime, and so on. We repeat this until we have found a prime number, then simply we add it to our list. It's a very inefficient algorithm, but so let's execute this algorithm. Check, yeah, it will actually do what we expected. Okay, so just assuming, yeah, all of those are prime numbers. 13, it looks good, so it's a prime number. So it gives us a list of all of 100 random prime numbers. So this program is very slow, and let's check how slow. So basically we can simply run, so instead of print find primes, we now import the C profile. So this is how simple it is to use the C profiler. Then we call C profile dot run and pass our command, which we want to run, as a string in our C profile function. That's it. Okay, so we simply pass it as a string. This was a program we previously executed, and now we use this wrapper function called wrapper function, the C profile dot run function, and now this function will just run the code within the string quotes and give us some statistics. So let's execute this. Now you can see these are the statistics we have obtained, and here, what does it mean basically? It tells us, so we still have the same output, so a similar output of 100 prime numbers, random prime numbers. And then it tells us, okay, there are 4,882 function calls, and the total program took 1.6 seconds. Okay, and then it gives us a table which is ordered by the standard name, okay, by the name of our function. So for each line we have one function. Like here we have the code.py, which is my file, the findPrime function, we have the guess function, we have the isPrime function, then we have the randint function. So these are all the functions we use in our code. So if you check the code, we have the isPrime function, guess function, the randint function, and so on. And it tells us what is the total time spent in this function, how often is this function called, what is the like percentage of calls, and so on. Yeah, what is the cumulative time in this function? And so oftentimes, so it's not good to order by standard name. Often we simply want to order by a certain column. Okay, so say we want to like order by the number of calls, then we would specify zero, because the number of calls is a zeroth column. But often the best way of structuring this output is to sort by the total time used. Okay, and this gives us directly the bottleneck of our whole application. So we restart the thing. Now you see that it's sorted by the total time it takes. And here you can see, okay, we have 560 calls in total time of 1.63 seconds. Out of our 1.64 seconds for the whole application, we have like 95% of our application or so. We are actually in our isPrime function. So this, like the isPrime function, this is our bottleneck. Why? Because we execute it very often, first, and second, because it's very inefficient. We have this nested for loop, okay? So it's a very inefficient way to check whether x is a prime number. Okay, and how do we overcome this problem now? So this is prime function. Now, as I already told you, the first thing you do is to check for algorithms. So is there a more efficient way of checking whether x is a prime number? And actually, if you just Google it quickly, you will find that there is a very efficient way of doing it. And I just copy paste this. So here, this function is prime 2. It also checks whether the number x is a prime, so it does exactly the same, but it's a very efficient function. There's no nesting of the loop, so it's not a nested for loop, it's now only one single for loop, and it doesn't go all the way to x, it goes only from the number 2 to the square root of x plus 1, okay? So therefore it doesn't go all the way and it's not nested. And then we use the modulo operation, and you see it, I mean, it's obviously it's much, much faster than our naive approach. But we only start optimizing after we have found that this function is actually the bottleneck. I mean, if this wouldn't be the bottleneck, it's not a problem that we have used the naive approach per se. So we don't have to use the most fancy approach at all times. We need to use the approach that works best. And in this case, so let's check whether this works best. So we replace isPrime by isPrime 2. So we use a new function and we profile the same thing. And remember, the previous output was 1.6 seconds. So we took the whole application took 1.6 seconds to execute, and now we execute again, and now you see 0.009 seconds. Okay, so this is a performance improvement. This is the type of performance improvement you get by repeatedly improving the bottleneck of your application. You won't reach this leverage point anywhere else. You have just improved your performance by 95% or so. Okay, just with a single tweak in your code. So there's no way you can reach this level of like the 10x or 20x performance improvement by like optimizing all the other parts of the code. So even if you spend the whole day making all these functions very, very efficient, like all other functions, making here to the last tweak you can think of. So you implement all these tweaks and caching and everything, but you apply to the wrong functions. And you don't focus on the isPrime function, which is obviously the bottleneck, then you will get a 1 or 2% improvement of performance, but not more. But if you have a single, so if you have identified your bottleneck with a cProfile tool like this, then you can immediately focus on a bottleneck. You do it 2 or 3 times, and then you have improved the performance of your application by usually 90-95%. Okay, so this is like a very important, very critical thing to remember. Always go for the bottlenecks. And you can use cProfiler. You now know how to use the cProfile run method, how to sort the output. And this is like, it's a very simple tool, but it's usually sufficient because you don't need to know a lot more about this. Yeah, so this is actually a cProfile. And you can also use the cProfile tool in a Flask application. I'm not going to discuss this here because there are just too many like different types of Flask applications, but yeah, you can check the write-up. I even gave some examples, and yeah, you can also Google it quickly. You can just Google how to use cProfile in a Flask application. Actually, there is a tool called Werkzeug. So if I go down. So here I just show how to use the cProfile in a Flask application. It's also possible, but then you can also, like, there's a wrapper for the cProfile package, which is called Werkzeug Config Profiler, and you can just like this profiler middleware, you can use it in your Flask application, and then it will just give you an output which is similar to our output here. It will give you the total execution time of your functions, and then you can start improving those functions. So spend the majority of your time figuring out the bottlenecks, making sure you know exactly where are the bottlenecks and why they appear, and then improving those bottlenecks. Okay, thanks for listening. In summary, we have the following concepts. Pre-mature optimization is the root of all evil. Measure first, improve second. Pareto optimization is king, so the 80-20 principle is well and alive in performance optimization. Then how to improve actually performance of your bottleneck, start with algorithmic optimization if possible, and then you can like go for other optimizations and tweaks like caching, for example. And always think whether you need the feature that is responsible for the bottleneck. So if you have identified a bottleneck and you cannot possibly fix it, then a good idea might be to just get rid of the feature that causes this bottleneck. And if you get rid of the feature, you have a lot of like space, a lot of time and effort left, which you can put into developing other features or reduced variants of the feature. So oftentimes it's just best to kick off the things that will slow you down most. And then you need to know when to stop. You need to like have a target, optimize to reach the target, and then finish optimizing if you have reached the target. Otherwise, you will just waste weeks and months tweaking and optimizing your code. Okay, thanks for listening and see you in the next video. Bye.